Bom dia, bonjour, hello, bom dia, everybody. So today we will enter in the wonderful world of singularities. That will be a completely new way, fantastic world of singularities, a new way to consider characteristic classes. First of all, we have to say what are the singular spaces we will work with. And I will So here are the guys we will work with. They will teach us singularities. René Thom, the first French mathematician. John Mazin, American one, and Asler Whitney, you know already, the climber, Asler Whitney. René Thom worked singularities and singularities in everything. He was fantastic, he had fantastic ideas. And maybe you know already René Thom by other fields and mathematics. But we have to say that René Thom is one of the founder of the singularity theory, as well as John Mazur and Asler Whitney. So you know already one example of singular space, which is a Pichet torus that you know already. The Pichet torus has a singular point A, and the neighborhood of the Pichet torus is not a sphere, is not a disk, and the boundary is not a sphere. If you take any regular point of the Pichet torus, there is a neighborhood which is a disk, and the boundary will be the sphere. The boundary will be called the link of the point. Here, if you take the point A, the neighborhood will be union of two cones, and the boundary will be union of two disk of two, one-dimensional sphere, the circle, okay? So if you have two circles and not one, this point is a singular point. The link is not a sphere, it's not a circle. Here is another example, the Pichet torus. How can you can imagine this in a four-dimensional space? If you take a circle like A, you can take the suspension of the circle, which is taking the product of the circle by a segment minus one plus one, okay? The product, which is a cylinder. And you pinch the cylinder at the point plus one, and you pinch the cylinder at the level minus one. This gives you a sphere, S2, topologically. Not differentiable, but topologically, okay? But now, instead of taking a circle, you take the torus, and you do the same operation with the torus. Of course, the torus is two-dimensional, so what you will obtain is three-dimensional, so it's more difficult to imagine, but I made the picture like that, that you have the product of the torus by minus one plus one, so this gives you a three-dimensional picture, and you pinch this picture at the level plus one and the level minus one. Now, what will be a neighborhood of this point A plus one at the level plus one? A neighborhood will be something more complicated, but the boundary of this neighborhood of A will be a small torus. Okay, you have torus at all levels. So the link is a torus. The link is not a sphere. And so the point A is a singular point because the link of the point is not a sphere. Okay, so this point A and B are also singular in this picture. Well, we have to imagine how to work with singular spaces. How to work with singular spaces, there are many ways to do that. And one way is to stratify. That is exactly the way Thom, Mazur, Whitney worked, and they give us the way to work with this space using stratification. The best is to look at this example. This is clearly a singular variety because, of course, if you take any point on this segment, the neighborhood of the point will not be a disk, and the boundary, the link, will not be a sphere. That is clear. And this is worst for the singular point, which is the crossing point of this cross. Okay. But if you take out all singular points, which is a set of points on this cross, so this cross here, if you take out this cross, the rest will be smooth, will be a manifold, two-dimensional. Okay. But so the difference between this picture X and the cross is a manifold, and it's a union of pieces which are two-dimensional, smooth, and these pieces are called the strata. The strata are manifold, they are smooth. Okay, now take the cross. The cross itself is singular. This is a singular point. If you take any point on this segment here, the neighborhood of the segment will be interval, and the boundary will be two points, which is S0, the sphere of dimension zero. So all these points are regular, of course, but the crossing point is singular, okay? Zero, the crossing point zero origin is singular. So we take out this point, which is singular, and the rest, the difference between the cross and the point, the rest will be regular and dimension one. So you have two-dimensional strata, you have one-dimensional strata, which are difference between the cross and the point. And finally, the point itself, which is zero-dimensional stratum. Okay, so strata are the difference at each stage of the filtration. Okay, well, the first condition we will ask for the strata is the frontier condition, which is come already from Tom, which says that the intersection, if the intersection of a stratum V alpha with the closure of V beta is not empty, then V alpha is contained in the closure of V beta. That is called the frontier condition, which is the condition that we will have on our example, the basic condition, I will say. Now there are a notion of stratification. What we are looking for the moment are topological stratification, but this stratification, the strata can be differentiable, can be analytic, and in that case, you have a differentiable stratification, analytic stratification, etc. So you have many possibilities for them. Well, so now we want to have condition. In fact, the strata are smooth, and we have to look at now the way you glue together the strata in order to recover your singular variety. Okay, so what is the way we will glue together? For this, we will use a notion of angle. I think this you know very well when you have vector space in some Euclidean space, and the notion of angle between a plane and a vector, etc. So I think I will not say anything about that, but you know very well the angle between two vectorial subspace in some space. Okay. The first condition we will work with will be the Whitney conditions, Whitney, which gives Whitney stratification. And this Whitney condition are very nice, and you will see that we will need this condition to work with when we want to look at the notion of characteristic classes given by Marie-Hélène Schwarz. The first is the following. V here, I have V alpha, this stratum, red stratum, which is in the closure of V beta, the blue stratum, okay? Well, so V alpha is in the boundary of V beta. V alpha is one dimensional, V beta is two dimensional. Take a sequence of points, xn, going to a point y in the small strata, y is in the alpha, okay? So xn is a sequence of points having a limit y. And assume that the tangent to the tangent space to v beta at the point xn, this tangent space, when xn goes to y, we assume that this tangent planes have a limit. Okay, so you take in each point xn the tangent plane at that point, and you assume that when the sequence xn goes to y, this sequence of tangent plane has a limit, which is t. T is the limit at that point. Okay, and as V alpha is a smooth, the strata has a smooth, okay? The strata are manifold. So you can take at this point y, the tangent space to the stratum V alpha, which is here in my picture, a line. So the A condition of Whitney says that in that case, the line, which is the tangent space to V alpha at the point y, is contained in the limit of this tangent plane to V beta at the point xn, okay? So this is the condition A. It's clear? Okay, the condition A, I think it's clear. We will see example later. The condition B is the following. The first condition is the same. You assume that there is a sequence of point xn going to y, xn in a big strata v beta, y in the small stratum v alpha. And you assume that xn has a limit y in v alpha, and you assume that the tangent plane to v beta at point xn has a limit t when the sequence of points xn goes to y, okay? So there is such limit t. But now we will take another sequence of points yn in the small strata v alpha. And we assume that the lines xn, yn here, okay, the sequence of lines has a limit when xn, yn goes to y. Okay, so you assume that this, the sequence of lines, this direction, I will say, sequence of direction has a limit when the point xn, yn goes to y. And the condition B, the Whitney condition B, says that the limit of this direction, which is lambda, okay, the limit of this direction is included in the limit of the tangent planes to v beta at points xn, which is t, the vector space t, okay? Okay, so these are the two conditions, A and B, and from now on, we will work a lot with these two conditions. But it's good to see what the condition A and B will be very useful for constructing the characteristic classes using the Marielle-Schwarz method. And in fact, the condition A, we will see that allows to extend a vector defined on a stratum. If you have a vector here in the stratum, it's clear that as the vector space, the tangent space to V alpha close to Y include at the limit include this TY of V alpha, if you have a vector in this ty of v alpha, it is this vector is in the limit t of the tangent space. So you can extend this vector in such a way that this vector, parallel vectors, will be in the tangent planes to v beta. We will see that more in details later on. Okay. But I want to show you examples where condition A and B are not satisfied, but you can arrange the stratification in order to obtain the condition A and B. Take a cone. take a cone which is singular. It's clear that the point Y here is a singular point, okay? And the neighborhood is two circles, as a boundary which is two circles. So the link will be two circles. You can imagine a simple stratification of the cone, taking a line D as V alpha, and the rest of the cone, which is smooth. The rest is smooth. If you take out the line D, the rest is smooth, and the rest has V beta. Now, first of all, the condition A is not satisfied, because if you take the tangent space to this point, if you take another generatrix, the red one, okay, and you take a sequence of points along this generatrix going to Y, it is clear that the tangent space to Xn to the cone, to the double cone, so there are planes here, and the which will give you the two-dimensional plane here. And the condition A says that this limit contains the tangents at Y to the small stratum D. And this is not true, because the tangent at point A, Y to the stratum D is a line which is along D, and it is clearly not contained in the limit of this point. And you can do by exercise by yourself, it's very easy to see that. And you can see also by yourself that the sequence of lines that I pictured here, Xn, Yn, this sequence of lines which is vertical, this sequence of lines is not included in the limit of the limit Y, the tangent space to D at the point Y, okay? And that is clear that A and B condition are not satisfied. Now, exercise, if you add this point Y as a zero dimensional stratum, so the stratification will be the cone minus D, then D minus Y, then the point Y alone. And in that case, condition A and B are satisfied. Okay, so you can, this will happen very often, that if you take a sub-stratification, then condition A and B will be satisfied. Okay, so that is clear. And here is another example where I took V alpha, the red line inside this variety whose equation in C3 is given here. And this is a classical example in the theory of singular spaces. It gives a lot of examples. And again, if you take this line, the red line, as a small stratum, and the rest at the two-dimensional stratum, the rest is regular, okay? Then it's easy to see that condition A in that case is satisfied, but not condition B. And you will have to add the point zero as a zero-dimensional stratum in order to satisfy condition A and B. That's clear? I think that's very important. Okay. Well, so witness stratification, as I said, are very important, and you will see that in the construction of Marielle and Schwarz class characteristic classes, that is absolutely necessary. Necessary, yes, it's necessary. I can say like that. I give you a definition of a real analytic in a real analytic manifold, a semi-analytic. We will work often with a semi-analytic space, semi-analytic space, which is defined by a family of equalities, F bigger than zero strictly, and F bigger or equal to zero in a neighborhood of each point, okay? So this is a definition, classical definition of semi-analytic, and this will be useful also for the following. So two main properties. The first one is that any closed analytic subset of an analytic manifold admits a witness stratification, and the strata are analytic. That is very important. And the second one, which is very, very important, is that if you have witness stratified spaces, you can triangulate according to, in a way that the triangulation is compatible with the stratification. What does it mean? It means that each simplex will be completely, entirely included in a stratum. You can have a simplex where the part is in the stratum and the other part in another stratum. No. Each simplex is completely included in a stratum. Okay, so this will be very, very useful as well. So the fact that if you have a witness stratified space, you can triangulate in such a way that each simplex is completely included in a stratum. And more of that, if you have a witness stratification, you have this theorem, Tom Mather theorem, which gives you locally what happens. And this picture is fundamental. Take the singular space that we have seen at the beginning, and take a point in one of these singular stratum, one-dimensional singular stratum. This point has a neighborhood in the singular variety, which is the product of a small interval, so which is, in general, it will be a ball with the same dimension of the stratum, sorry. So, is a product of this interval by a cross here. Okay, this is a product. The cross, what is the cross? Here in this example, the cross is if you take the point which is here in the cross is a cone over 1, 2, 3, 4 points. If you take 4 points and the fifth point here, and you take the cone with this fifth point as a vertex and the cone on the 4, you obtain the cross. Okay, so it is a cone over what is called the link of the point X. And this is a property which is a Tom Mather theorem, which says that if you have a stratification, witness stratification, for every point in a stratum V alpha, there is such which we call distinguished neighborhood, which is the product of a ball in the stratum with the dimension of the stratum by the cone over a link, and the link, in general, it will be some variety which can be singular as well. And this link is stratified, here you have the stratification which is given by this filtration. And the cone will be the second term of the product. And what is more interesting is that if you take intersection of this neighborhood with any set of the filtration of X, then you will have the cone over the corresponding set here, the corresponding space in the filtration of the link. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that this homeomorphism here respects the stratification of U, the filtration and the stratification of U, and the filtration stratification of the link. Okay, so the two filtration, the two stratification of X and of the link are compatible. Okay, that is very important. Okay, I think that is clear. Also, sometimes the link being empty for the point, of course, a cone over empty set is a point. Okay, so that is very important. The distinguished neighborhood U is the product of a ball by the cone, and respecting the filtration, the stratification of U, and the filtration, the stratification of L. Okay. Maybe I can return here. If you take zero, you will see that the cone zero is a point. So B alpha will be a point, will be the point, and the cone over the link will be the set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8, 8 segment, which is in fact, if you have a S1, 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 and you can see the second property, the main property, that the filtration of U is compatible with the filtration of the cone over the link. You can see that as an exercise. It's very easy to see that. Well, we will use also Alexander isomorphism. What is Alexander isomorphism? For define Alexander isomorphism, I have to define what is a cellular tube. We come back to the triangulations. Here I have the space X, which is singular, which is this set of three half line. Okay, this is X, the singular set. Of course, it's singular because this point is a singular point. I take a triangulation which is compatible with the stratification of X, which is the stratification is very easy, the singular point and the rest. Okay, the rest is smooth, is union of three half lines. And I take a triangulation compatible with the stratification. What does it mean? It means that, for example, this simplex is entirely in one stratum. Okay. And this simplex cannot be whoops like that. It is completely in the stratum. Well, and I took the cellular dual decomposition of the space. Okay, this you know very well. So I take a triangulation compatible with the stratification, and I take the cellular decomposition, dual decomposition. You see very well that in M, M is the plane, and X, this subspace, in M, which is smooth, which is a plane, the cellular decomposition is also a good, very good cellular decomposition with cells which are homeomorphic to a disk, okay? Huh? And the boundary is homeomorphic to S1. Now, the set of dual cells of simplices which are in X, so this dual cells here, will be called a cellular tube around X. Okay, I think it's clear with this picture. And what is very important is that you have here the boundary of this cellular tube. Okay, you have other cells, of course, in M, but I take only the cells which are dual of simplices in X. And the boundary is made, for example, here, this one-dimensional cell in the boundary is dual of a simplex which is not in X. This one as well. Okay, so what is important is that the boundary of the cellular tube around X is made of, is composed of cells which are dual of simplices which are not in X. Okay, so this is the boundary of the cellular tube. You have two properties. First of all, it's clear that if I take out X in this cellular tube, if I take out X, I can project, I can restrict, use a restriction of the cellular tube minus X on the boundary. Okay, Because in that case, I have no problem for this point. This point does not exist. But if clear that if I take x, it's not true. Where will be sent this point of x, here or here? On this point, it's worst. So, but if I take out x, the rest, the tube minus x, can be restricted on the boundary. Okay. And also, it's clear that the cellular tube itself can be retracted to x. Okay. So the cellular tube has these two properties. T is a compact neighborhood of x containing x in this interior, and the boundary is a retract of the tube minus x, exactly what we have seen. And the cellular tube, it retracts to x, to the singular variety x. So we can define the Alexander isomorphism, which is when you have such x here, singular in M, on the cellular tube around x, okay? You take, it's clear that if you take a dual cell, which is not in the boundary, then this dual cell is dual of a simplex in x. For example, this dual cell is dual of the point. And this dual cell one-dimensional is dual of this simplex, okay? But a cell which is in the boundary, we have seen, is not dual of a simplex in x. So you don't take these cells, dual cells. So the dual cells of the dual tube minus modulo the dual cells which are in the boundary, there is here an isomorphism. The dual cell corresponds to a simplex in X. Okay? So you take the cochain, we have already seen that, the cochain, which corresponds to this dual cell here, of a dual cell which meet X. If it's not empty, then the dual cell is dual of a simplex sigma e in x. Okay, so you correspond to this dual cell cochain, considered as a cochain, the simplex which is in x. And this, the boundary, co-boundary and boundary, we have already seen that for the Poincaré duality. So there is a commutative diagram, and you can go to cohomology and homology. So you have an isomorphism of the cohomology of the dual tube modulo the boundary with homology of X, simply taking dual cell. Okay. Now, this cohomology is isomorphic to T modulo T minus X because there is a retraction of T minus X on the boundary of the dual tube. Okay. Of the cellular tube. So the first isomorphism is given by retraction, by this retraction of T minus X on the boundary. And the second isomorphism is by excision by M minus T. Okay, and you know in cohomology that you have such isomorphism given by excision. So this here is isomorphic to H, the cohomology of M modulo M minus X. So this is exactly this Alexander isomorphism that will play a big role in the following. So thank you for your attention and Fickenbein.